So we're going to kick off now because it's 1 o'clock on the dot. And I'd like to thank everyone for coming and joining our webinar with Landor today. And we're joined with the lovely Orla Neligan from Cornershop Productions.
Hello, everyone.
I'll just introduce Orla quickly, and she may extend her introduction then afterwards. So Orla's a writer. She's a producer, a director, and a stylist at Cornershop Productions, which is a creative media company. And I've worked with Orla a lot and thoroughly enjoy her work. And Orla, you might give the attendees a glimpse into your background and how you started out, and maybe some of your favourite projects, some interesting names you've worked with along the way. I'm sure you've plenty, so feel free to fire ahead.
Yeah, sure. Firstly, hello, everyone, and thanks for joining us today. So a little quick intro for those of you who may not know me. My name is Orla Neligan. I'm a creative director, a stylist, and a journalist, and I own Cornershop Productions. So as Rachel said, we're a creative media company. We do a lot of content creation, ads, branding. We do a lot of still photography, video, product styling, set design for a huge range of clients, from corporate to media, a lot of celebrities and big and small producers. And our work is really varied. We do a lot of food. So I've worked with Lidl, Dunn's, Butler's Pantry. We've worked with interior styling companies, Woody's, and loads of different smaller producers. We've worked with media, so magazines and press, and some celebrities like Pip O'Connor, Glenda Gilson. So we've had a really large kind of variety of work. For today, though, I thought it'd be really nice to focus on our homes because we've obviously been spending a lot of time in them in the last few months. But I also do a lot of interior styling as well. So I thought it'd be a nice one to do because over the last few months, we haven't really had the luxury of browsing through shops. And many of our budgets are constrained. So I thought it's nice to look at what we do have in the house, how we can repurpose or update a space with what we have. So I thought that'd be a nice one to start with. The thing about styling is it's really the thing that can finish off a space or a room, but it can often feel intimidating because you're faced with a big open room or an empty shelf or an empty corner. And sometimes we don't have the confidence to know what to put in it, or we can't put our finger on what's missing, or, you know, you just don't know how to finish off the look. So I thought for the first video, I'm going to talk about styling essentials. These are my go-to styling tools, these tried and tested items that I always come back to. And that are the great thing about them is they can be changed up for different spaces in the house. And, you know, there's always things that you have probably in your own home as well. So what I have done, just to explain, is I've pre-recorded some videos of me demoing these, because it's easier than dragging you all through my house and setting up videos here and there. So I'll be talking live over some of them as well. So will we kick off with that one, Rachel, the first one?
Brilliant, yeah. And I just wanted to note out as well, Orla, I'm sure there's a lot of attendees watching it, and including myself, we're desperate for something new to do with our living spaces because we're sitting here all day long and it's very monotonous and repetitive. So until we get back to the office, which is a little bit longer for some people, just what we can do in the meantime. And some people obviously have a natural flair for creativity and they're quite good at interiors, but for those who aren't as creative or a little bit shy around interiors, I think what you have to offer would be brilliant.
Well, I think it's good to note as well that our homes have had to work really, really hard over the last few months. They've been schools, they've been gyms, they've been offices, they've been, you know, everything really to us. So it's about kind of looking at the space a little differently. And as I said, you can update and repurpose those little spaces or pockets of your home a lot of the time by just changing things up, changing them out, or, you know, dressing them differently with all stuff you kind of have already. So that's the idea. So I think we'll start with the styling essentials. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start the video and share my screen, and hopefully everyone can hear. So let me just do that. Here we go. Everyone, can you see that there, Rachel? Yeah.
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, perfect. So I'm going to start. What I'm going to talk about is my styling essentials. And these are my go-to styling tools, those items that have been tried and tested by me many times,
across a variety of projects that I always seem to come back to. So we'll do a run through of those. And I suppose the idea behind this, as I mentioned in the intro, is that you know, we're looking at our own homes, how to repurpose and update spaces with items that we already have, because obviously we've been in lockdown for a long time at this stage, and we might not have had the luxury of browsing through shops, and also some of our budgets might have been constrained. So it's looking at what we have in the house already, and without spending a fortune, or you know, without having to go anywhere. So the great thing about these items is that they're interchangeable for various spaces, so you can use them in kitchens, bathrooms, living rooms, hallways, dining rooms, bedrooms, and also that they're likely to be items you have in your own house, so you can shop your own home. So that's the idea. So what I've done is I've laid out a lot of items here behind me on a table. I did this a few days ago on a really nice sunny day, thinking, oh, this will be lovely. And it was so bright. The glare was ridiculous. You couldn't see anything. So I'm out here today in between showers, and hopefully I don't get lashed on. So fingers crossed. So I'm going to just move the camera so I can take you through all the items and you can see everything. So firstly, we're going to look at trays. So trays are a great styling tool because they collate all your small items together, acting like a sort of a box, but they're also act like mini vignettes. So what's a mini vignette, I hear you ask, or what's a vignette even? A vignette is a display of items that tell a sort of a story, that is usually a representation of a larger room, but on a smaller scale. So you can put some things together and that can be a little display in itself just on a tray. And what I've done is I've pulled out some of my own trays here just to show you. So by changing up the mood, by changing up the texture and tone of the tray, sorry, you can change up the mood of a space or the style of a space or a room. So for example, some metallic trays, gold and silvers, and they can work really well for adding a looks factor to a space. In the foreground, I've just pulled out some casual trays, tins and tin trays and wooden trays, and they're very good at paring back spaces and keeping it more casual. But if you have a really nice decorative tray, it can be nice to hang that on a wall sometimes, or if you have a big shelf and you've got a decorative tray, you can stand it in the shelf as a sort of a backdrop. So that's trays. The next thing is candles. So well, obviously what you put into a space is key to styling, but often what's overlooked is the mood of a room or a space, and candles can really help elevate that. Because not only do they change the ambience of a room from day to night by just lighting them, but also you can create atmosphere with their scent. So for example, you might choose a musky, earthy scent for Christmas and a light floral scent to freshen up a bedroom. But they're also great for filling spaces. You just have to be mindful of the scale of the space. So if you have a really large room or a table, the larger candlesticks or container candles or pillar candles, or even grouping small votives together can work very well in large spaces and for adding height to long, large tables or mantelpieces. And then the smaller candles work very well in small spaces like trays, bedside tables, bathrooms, and that kind of thing. So that's candles, and they're a great styling tool. I use them a lot, and they work in any space, bathrooms, hallways, anywhere. So next is books. So when I talk about books for this category, I kind of also include magazines and reading books, which I use a lot when I'm styling. You can change up the mood and style of a space by just changing the books. So for example, if you have a contemporary modern coffee table, for example, and you want that modern minimalist look, you can opt for monochrome fashion books. Or for a more playful space, you can pull out books with colourful spines, which will update the space. And they're also great as plinths, so like you can pop little items on them, like little plants, little decorative objects, and they act like a little mini vignette or tray in themselves. And they're just great for layering, to create different heights, and the type of books you choose can really reflect your personality too, so they can inject that life into spaces, and they can tend to pull a room together sometimes too. So that's books. Fourth is art. So by art I don't just mean paintings or prints. This also includes like personal objects, artifacts, sculpture, all which can add a sense of life and interest to a space, which makes your eye travel. Also, so much nicer to include your own personality in a space. So just having those items really reflects who you are. It's your home, it's your space after all. You can fill a space with shop-bought stuff. I definitely think there's a place for that, that's fine. But I just think it's nicer to have your own little objects and art that reflects who you are. So that comes in the guise of those things that maybe have been gifted to you, for example, or you've picked up on your travels, or that mean a lot to you for whatever reason. So maybe handmade items, photographs of loved ones, sculpture that you've bought with a great story or memory. You know, I've included a little snapshot of things here, just to give you an idea, like the oil on canvas and prints. And this painting, I just pulled this out because I have it on its own on a wall in my house. And I just think sometimes it's just to give an example of how you can use one piece of art, one key piece of art, to make a statement. This is quite dramatic because of its colour. It sits on a navy wall. So it kind of, it's all, it just works by itself. It's all the wall needs. Like pictures on a mantelpiece or a picture rail is quite nice. And then you can intersperse with smaller items around. But that is art. And lastly, plants and flowers. So these are a great styling tool because they just add life to spaces, really. They can fill empty spaces very well if you have a tall plant. And they're so variable and interchangeable that you can dress spaces in a certain style or colour depending on what flowers or plants you use. They're also great as a final flourish on a table, a great way to add drama or impact to a space. So like I love using tall green branches in a big urn on a hall table, for example. That can be quite dramatic. Or like strong mono colours of flowers in various pockets of a room. This can draw your eye, creating a really cool moment that can be quite graphic as well. So they're a great tool because they're so varied and they're so graphic, and they obviously have various heights and colours and everything. So it's just, they're a great styling tool that can be used anywhere. So they are essentials, things that can be interchanged, as I said, in various spaces. And as I said again, like likely to be things you find in your own house. So it's a good idea to maybe pull out all the things that you do have, play around with them, see what works. Maybe a bedside table, you could update that by playing around with a little picture or a plant or a tray or a candle. So just have a look at what you already have. Sometimes when we're living with our items, we can't see them anymore. So I sometimes think it's nice to pull everything out on a table and just have a look at everything and maybe move it to a different room or a different space. So they are my five styling essentials. I think what I'm going to do now is stop the video and take you inside to show you.
Yeah, so I'll just stop it there. I'll stop the share as we can go back to us. I always think that's a good intro because there's a list there of items that can be used in various spaces. So you can move them around the house and they'll work really anywhere. So that's kind of a basis of what we're talking about today. The second video is open shelving. So I thought that's a nice one. Everyone has shelves in their house, whether that's in a bathroom or a kitchen or wherever. So this is just a run through of how to style open shelving. So I'll start that one.
Dawn, Orla, I just had a quick question. And people might be wondering, just if you don't have fresh flowers all the time, like would you recommend using the fake kind? Or
fake flowers a few years ago were a big no-no. They were like plastic, really plastic. But they've come a long way and I would use them a lot in styling certain spaces. And I know they're really handy. So you don't have to change out dirty, you know, water and dying flowers. They've come a long way and there's a lot of shops and even online that are doing faux plants and faux flowers that are really real. So I can, if someone wants to get in touch with me about that, I can give them a list of places to check.
Super. Brilliant. Yeah.
No problem. So we'll start our shelf styling video now. I'm just going to share my screen for that. Here we go. Okay.
So the next thing we're going to talk about is open shelving. I get asked a lot about the anatomy of the shelving. So what creates a balanced look on a shelf, or how do you allow items to stand out? And there's a few rules of thumb. And that can be used anywhere on any shelf, whether that's kitchen, bathroom, living room, sitting room, the same rules really apply. So the first thing to remember is to always stagger heights. So if you have a lot of items on a shelf, for example, photo frames or pictures that are the same level or height, your eye isn't really going to be drawn to anything in particular, and everything will become a little flat and boring. So to always remember to stagger the heights. Secondly, I always try and incorporate plants when I can. They just add a lot of visual interest and they fill spaces really well. So if you have a large or tall shelf, you can fill that space really well with a good sized plant. Thirdly, if you're grouping objects, to always do so in threes or odd numbers. Believe it or not, it actually creates a more balanced look. For some reason, even numbers just don't work that well, and that goes for most styling compositions, whether it's vignette or flat lay. So the odd number rule is important. Also, when you're styling shelves, to sort of think about space, it's important that the items have a visual breathing space, because actually, if you overcrowd the space, it just becomes busy and you don't really see anything at all. So a bit of negative space here and there is really good, because it's often those quieter moments that actually draw your eye to what's actually there. So to remember that. And also mixing textures and tones. I always try to include something organic on the shelves, whether that's a plant, a wooden sculpture, seashell, something handmade, for example. That can work quite well. And mixing those up, so traditional with contemporary, modern with vintage, that can work quite well. So maybe an old photograph next to something ceramic that's new, or a shell next to a plant, or a wooden sculpture. So mixing your textures and tones. Also, just to remember that it is your house and your shelf, so having your own personality in there is really important. So those personal items, to pull those out, things that might be gifted to you or find that means something, things that are handmade, etc., and they just tell a visual story, and that's what makes things interesting and draws people's eye to a shelf. And also, just lastly, the triangle or diagonal line theory, and I'll explain that. So in styling, we often use what's called the triangle or diagonal line method, which is, if you have, for example, something on the top shelf that's black, you're not going to place something black directly below it, but you might do so to the outer edges of the next shelf down to create that triangle effect, which creates balance. And the same goes for a diagonal theory as well. And repeating themes maybe three times in a room can create a nice balanced look as well. So that's about eight, I think, tips and tricks for styling shelves. And what I'm going to do is actually talk you through those using my shelf behind me. I cleared out this shelf. This is just a shelf in my house that was in dire need of a clean out. And I cleared it out and just started updated. And while I was doing so, I just used those rules of thumb while I was doing it, so I could show you. So for example, my shelves are not even. So I started with the largest shelf here, and it's the tallest shelves. And I've put some bigger items in there, like the largest plant I have to fill the gap. Some stacks of books, and here's my rule of three here. So you have three items that are sort of complement each other. So you've got these little gold based bunny ears that are white as well. You've got a gold based candle with white and a white sea urchin. So it's a rule of three, but the colours are kind of in keeping. I have a picture stacked to the back, but I just wanted to show you, if I took that out, earlier we were talking about how decorative trays work really well. Hopefully you can still hear me, sorry. If you pop a tray in the back there, if you've got a large shelf, you can see how that just creates a good backdrop. And it's a metallic tray, so it's nice and reflective, and it also creates a bit of a looks factor, but it fills the space really well. So if you have a nice tray, you can pop it in at the back somewhere on a shelf. Below that, I've got a really nice bowl and some, again, my rule of three, some nice decorative pieces, staggering the heights again, and a little candle, so that's higher again. On the top shelf, I've just stacked some books two different ways, just for variety and visual interest. And I've popped a few personal items up here. So these bowls, vintage bowls from Morocco, a little Moroccan teapot, some flowers behind, and then next to that, a really old vintage camera. So this is telling a bit of a story, which you can do with all your personal items that have been gifted to you, that you've brought back from holidays or whatever. This this was a picture from my sister gave me from Japan, and then a gift from my parents of a cat, because I love cats. So as you can see, it's sort of like telling a little bit of a story here. Then I've included some, always included some organic items on every shelf, really. So I've got some greenery, some plants, this little wooden sculpture of New York, got some seashells down here, a little ram's horn I collected in Kerry. So yeah, there's kind of a variety of organic things, and they're mixed in with your likes of your tray, your gold tray or your bowl, magazines and books, just to kind of vary it up. And then your rule of your diagonal rule or your triangle rule, you've got something black up here. So I'm not going to mirror that exactly below. Instead, I've gone over here with something black, and then the diagonal rule, another black item here, and then again down here. Sorry, you can't really see the bottom shelf there, so I'm just going to move that slightly. So you've got like, you've got that triangle rule going on. Also the staggering height, so I've made sure that, you know, you've got different height levels, like the candle here, the sculpture is higher, there's a candle here that's higher, you know, the picture frame is higher, plant somewhere in the middle. So yeah, you're staggering heights, and you're including personal items, you're including organic items, and you're not overcrowding the space. Like we all have a tendency, me included, to throw everything you like up there, but often that's actually counterproductive. It just creates busyness on a shelf, and you don't really see anything. So just remember that. So that's kind of an idea of how you style open shelves, using a few examples and a few tricks and tips. I think we're going to do coffee table styling next.
Stop that there. And stop the share. So yeah, that was the open shelving, and that's a good one. The rules on that one are kind of applied to anywhere at any shelf, really. So hopefully there's some tips there that people can pick up. And the last video is going to be coffee table styling. The thing about coffee tables is, like, you know, everyone has a table in their house, and I know they're varying in size and shape. So round, rectangle, square. And maybe some people have little small end tables. But the same rules really apply. It's all about, with coffee tables, it's all about balance. So if you've got items that are too big for the space, they're going to overpower it. Items too small, they're going to disappear. So I always try and use the quadrant or third rule. So usually if you have a square table or big rectangle table, splitting it in four or three is a good idea. Also that applies to round. The two rule can work quite well on a very small table, or if you have a very small table, you can stack one display as long as it's balanced properly. So there, that's the kind of rule of thumb when it comes to coffee tables. If your home is anything like mine, your coffee table is probably full of Lego or crayons or whatever. I have three small kids, and most people can probably relate to, you know, to that. But I know coffee tables are functional, and they have to be functional. So a good way to get around that is the bits and bobs is, I often use trays. If you haven't guessed, I love a tray. You know, to put in your remote controls and your bits and bobs, it just collates things and keeps it kind of neater. And also when I have people around, my coffee table doesn't look like this all the time, but when I have people around, I like to kind of clear the decks and just style it properly. And then during the week, the kids put all their stuff on it. So it's just nice to dress it every now and again. So, we'll start there's four videos here, and I'm going to show you one by one, and I'm going to talk live over them. So just to give you an idea, and I'm going to share the screen. So you just tell me, Rachel, you can see that.
Yeah.
All good?
That's perfect.
Yeah. So this coffee table, this is the first one, and this, I have a very big square coffee table. And so I need to get the scale and the balance right with this. So for the first video, I've split it in quadrants. So I'm just going to show you this one first. I'll talk you through it as I'm doing it. So the first thing I'm doing is I'm placing a very tall vase top left of greenery. Obviously this is a lockdown, so no access to flowers. So I'm using what I have in my garden, but sometimes greenery is really nice. It's just branches. So I have a nice tall vase of greenery. Then I've got some monotone kind of coffee table books to the right, and a handmade organic bowl. So that's a little bit of height in the bowl, but it's not as high as the vase. So the staggering heights. In the foreground, I have another coffee table book and some little decorative items. So visual interest. And then to the right of that, I'm placing a round tray. if I had a round coffee table, I might use a square tray. The idea is that you don't use the same shapes all the time. So this breaks the shapes. If you've got square rectangle books, and you know, the square table, this just helps soften the shapes and the space. And on that I've placed a couple of personal items, some greenery, so the rule of three again. And then behind that, in the one of the quadrants, I'm putting a piece of coral just for to fill the gap a bit. So that's, I'll just pause that. So as you can see, I've, you know, there's four pockets of the coffee table that you can see pretty well. Your eye is drawn to all of them. And they all create a bit of visual interest. They're all different. So that's the first one. I'll just close that.
Question while you're chatting through that. Would you recommend changing items on the table to face the direction where people are coming into the room? Would you focus the kind of...
Not necessarily. No, and it's a good question, because some people have a round table, so that's kind of, you know, some people have a rectangle and it faces their couch. So I suppose you have to look at the shape of your room. Where are you sitting? Like, where is your main kind of sitting area? And you're going to be sitting in front of that a lot of the time. So what do you want to look at? I guess. Yeah, I mean, it depends on the shape of the table. It depends on your seating area, how you orientate that, I guess.
Yeah. You should be getting the enjoyment out of it as well as your guests coming to the house.
Yeah, that's it, exactly. I mean, it's for you. I mean, I know. I mean, I'm guilty of it too. I mean, our coffee table is, as I said, Lego half the week, you know. But I do like, every now and again, I love fresh flowers. So I love putting just a vase of flowers even on a tray and throwing the remote controls on it just to make it look nicer than, you know, scattered stuff everywhere. So, yeah, it's a good question though. So the second one, this is, let me just share this video, share the screen with you. This is the second one, and this is where I've divided the table in three. So this is the quadrant and third rule, kind of, I do quite a lot. So this is the third rule where I've divided in three. So I'll just show you this. So the first thing I'm doing, I've obviously dropped something there. So the first thing I'm doing is a round tray, top left. And on that, I'm going to place a smaller floral display, but that's full. So here I'm using my roses from the garden, but I love peonies are also good. Hydrangea, it's also a really nice full flower just to fill the space. On the tray, I'm putting a candle and then a little paperweight that's pink. So it ties in with the color of the roses. And then I think I'm putting in some marble coasters. So these are practical, functional. You know, you'd have coasters on your coffee table and they're you know, easy to get to, so they're accessible on the tray. Then to the right of that, I've got adding some staggered height with some candlesticks. So that fills the space quite nicely. You could also put a lovely big urn there if you have a nice decorative urn or vase. And then lastly, in the foreground, I'm going to pause it here actually just to explain what I'm doing. I've opened a coffee table book, and I suppose I just love doing that because sometimes the coffee table books are a bit overlooked, in the sense that they're just used as plinths or stacked. And I just love the idea of opening the book because, you know, it's nice. It's to entice people to actually flick through it when they're in your house. Because a lot of the coffee table books, that's the point of them. So I've opened the book on the table there just to show you. So that's the three rule. And as you can see, I've placed the tray off center a bit. I don't like centering things on a square or rectangle table. So the tray is off center. So it creates a bit of a variety and interest to the eye. There's three different levels of height and everything you can see really well. So that's number two. I'll just stop the share there. And then number three is, because I have this really big table, I have done another quadrant. So another four. For people just to see how you could split it up again in a different way in four. So I'll show you this one. So what I'm doing is a coffee table book, and on that I'm putting a wooden rectangular tray. On the tray, I've got my three rule again. So I've got my bell jar with a little plant, so something green. I've got a higher candle and then a smaller little book of candle. So that's my rule of three. And then I think on the top left, I've got another book, which I've changed the direction of just for interest. And I have a nice, really big, full fern plant. So nice pop of green and it's in a nice decorative kind of plant pot. So that's again a bit interesting. Then the foreground, a metallic silver tray, and on this I've placed quite a few organic items, so keeping it quite clean and fresh. So all the colors, all the items are white, some shells and a little white candle. So that's quite a neutral palette there. And then on the right, if you have some nice decorative objects that are worthy of kind of standing alone, it's nice not to put them on anything. It's just nice to leave them out on the table. If I get out of the way, you could probably see. I've got two decorative items there that just work on their own in the foreground of the table. So, and this is a good point, actually, Rachel, the question you made there about whether to orientate the items in a different direction. You could move, if your decorative items are not seen very well from over here on the couch, you could switch it all around. If the plant is covering what's in behind, then certainly you could move the smaller items to the foreground.
And I suppose a lot of people like to maybe put focus on their fireplace. If they've got a beautiful fireplace, you might then maybe angle everything to the left and the right of the table so you can
see. Yeah, absolutely. The height, sometimes the height then might not go directly in the middle if it's blocking the fireplace. It could go at the back left or right, you know. So that's number three. And then I've just done one more, which is an example of something that would suit a really small table, like an end table or a very small coffee table. And the idea behind this, obviously, it does not suit my coffee table because it's a little bit lost, but it's just for the purpose of showing you that it's a one sort of display and it's nearly like a vignette in itself, just a small display. So I'm just stacking some simple two-tone coffee table books in two different grays. And then I've got the fern plant again with the nice pot. I've got a candle, I think. Again, I'm in the way, so you'll have to wait and see. A candle and something organic. I think it's the ram's horn and a lovely little sculpture. And the colours all tie in together. It's not overcrowded, you see everything. And it's all on the one plinth, if you know what I mean, all on the coffee table book. So that can work quite well if you have a small space, a small table, an end table or coffee table that you just want to give it a little bit of life. So that is number four. That's the three how-tos. So hopefully they give some people some ideas as what you can do with some of the spaces in your house, tables, shelves, and even just pockets, pockets of your bedroom or your kitchen or whatever. I think hopefully there's some tips there.
Absolutely. And I think with this last burst of doing up your home, I know, again, I said people are starting to move back to the office now. So it's your one last chance to get your house in order, your apartment in order, or whatever living space you have that you're working out of. It's your last chance to kind of fix it up and maintain it, I suppose, is the next chance.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, we've all been staring at our own spaces for so long. In the last, you start to see things differently, or you start to notice things that you didn't notice before because you're always on the go and in a hurry. So, you know, it's nice to kind of have that time in a way to kind of look at a pocket of your house and go, God, I never noticed how cluttered that section was or that shelf was. And it just breathes life into spaces when you can, you know, have some time to think about restyling them, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. That was amazing, Orla, like unbelievable amount of tips and tricks that I will definitely be starting tonight, especially with the coffee table, even as a starting point, because I'm going to be chilling out on the couch later anyway, so I might as well look at that first.
Yeah. So, well, one thing to note about that, Rachel, is no matter what you're doing at home, I always feel it's a really good idea to pull, I think I mentioned this in the Styling Essentials video, to pull everything out on the floor or on a table that you love, whether that's books, vases, magazines, art, flowers, plants, everything, and just look at what you have, you know, all out in front of you, and then start playing around with swapping things in and out. It's really the only way to kind of really get a feel for what's going to work in a space when you've everything out in front of you.
Sure, good advice. Yeah. We have loads of questions in. I won't bombard you with all of them. We'll just throw a few out there. So I've got one from Richard. He wants to know how he may make his storage a little bit more stylish. And I know that I myself struggle with this one too massively, where I kind of think I'm going to set up some nice storage, have it all in boxes, but it ends up turning into an absolute mess. And it's just like a pile of junk in a box thrown in the corner. So that's a good one, I think.
Oh, yeah, I'm guilty of that too. Like, yeah, it is. But the great thing about storage is that there's so many lovely storage solutions out there, I guess. Now, there's lovely baskets, there's lovely boxes. We have a load of like lovely peg rails with shelves that are lovely to hang stuff off that just look a bit nicer. They're painted. So I think, you know, depending on where your storage area is, you can synchronize the storage baskets or boxes and colors or styles, or, you know, to kind of keep it cohesive. But you can also, if it's open storage, you can intersperse those with little plants or a bit of art, just to make it more visually enticing than just a load of stuff stuffed in a box, you know?
Yeah, brilliant. And I have another question in here from Natalie. Trouble finding a nice office space at home. Now, I know a lot of our members joining us today will have that same issue because they're so used to working from an office space. What can they do in the meantime until it's safe to go back to work to find that nice office space or to try and find a nice place where you can work for the whole day and make it a little bit more stylish as well?
Yeah, it's a good question. And I've been asked this a lot, actually.
Orla's is frozen there. Just give it a few minutes.
And they have been offices, they have been schools, they have been gyms, they've been everything. And so it is about kind of just looking at the space differently. So for example, an alcove is a typically underused space. So, and it can support a workspace really well. So if you have a little alcove that you can stick a chair in, you know, there's if you can split a room, does your living room double up if it's a big enough that you could put a table in a corner? Have you a dressing table that you could clear off a section of, or a whole table that's a bit lonely that isn't very noisy? Or sometimes shelving, like a cupboard, you know, that has shelves already in it, that has doors, even better, that you can close over at night. If you stick a stool or a chair up against, that can work well. Or even a dividing wall. Sometimes all you need is the space for a laptop, a little bench or a shelf and a laptop and a chair and a dividing wall in a kitchen or something you can work against. And then if you're lucky enough to have a shed, we are lucky enough to have a shed, which is full of props, but I still have a corner of it that I can use. So yeah, it's just about rethinking the space you have, looking at it a bit differently, I think.
Excellent. I know for me anyway, I'm using my little plug-in radiator to stack my books on, which isn't ideal. Yeah. It does the job.
That's inventive. As long as it doesn't set them on fire, but you know.
When it's off. Great. So I have one more question here. It's quite a basic one, but maybe you might be able to shed a little bit of light. I don't know what my style is. Where do I start? This is from Sarah.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. It is tricky to figure out your style. I sometimes start with like past or present. So are you into vintage antiques? Do you like modern contemporary? So that's kind of a good way to kind of steer yourself. Also, if you walk into a room, you ask yourself the question, how do I want to feel? Like, do you want to feel like you're at the beach? Do you want to feel like you're in a cozy log cabin? Do you want it to feel fresh and airy and light? Or do you want it to feel cozy and dark? That can kind of help distinguish where you're going with your style. And then you can ask friends and family. Sometimes it's nice to get an objective. Your family might know you better than anyone and say, well, you've this kind of style. It'll help you decipher, you know, which direction to go in.
Super, brilliant. That's a good one. Ask people. That's a very good one. I never thought.
Yeah, ask people.
Seems so basic and obvious.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Well, that's super. Thanks so much, Orla. Loads and loads of tips to come out of that that people can use today. And like you said, recycling things around the house. I'm looking around me now and I'm kind of thinking what can be dumped, what can be used again, what I can paint.
Yeah, what you can paint and repurpose, exactly. Yeah, it's great to kind of be able to do that as opposed to going buying loads of new stuff, you know?
Exactly, yeah. I've loads of questions coming in, but I might hold off because we're running out of time and it's moving on to 22 quarters.
Well, the other thing to mention, Rachel, is if people are interested, my website has an opt-in so you can get a lovely styling kind of tips and tricks maybe once a month. It's not, I don't bombard people, but it's nice to just keep up with that. It's sort of a creative notebook. But also people can email me through the website or through Instagram. It's Orla Neligan and Cornershop. If they want, I can answer any questions after.
That's super brilliant. Look, again, thank you so much for joining us here and looking forward.
Thank you for having me. It was so much fun. I loved it.
Brilliant. Looking forward to keeping an eye out on what's to come next with Cornershop.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to seeing everyone's lovely styling.
Brilliant. Thanks so much again, Orla.
Brilliant. Thanks, guys. See you. Bye.